Australia since the time immemorial, and that is Patrick White. The reason I mention Patrick White is that in 1939 he published a book called Happy Valley, his first novel. And it has an epigraph from Mahatma Gandhi. At that time, most Australians were opposed to Mahatma Gandhi because Gandhi was trying to dismantle this large British empire that was ruling the world for the last 200 years, and particularly in India, some of the most atrocious things were being committed. But Patrick White recognized Gandhi's greatness in 1939, when he took from an essay called Suffering a little epigraph, and that is the epigraph of his book called Happy Valley, which has recently been published. And Patrick White has a very special role in our lives. My wife, mine, my three children, who are here. One of them is an academic, and she just left IU to go to Sydney, and my two children are in Australian Foreign Service. But the point I'm making is that when I read him in this little hotel in London, I was studying there, I was so moved by his two books, The Tree of Maine and Voss. And I recommend very highly to you that whatever you are doing, and I'm sure you're doing wonderful things in technical colleges, in postgraduate studies, do read Patrick White, probably the greatest writer this country has produced, and certainly, in my opinion, the greatest writer in our region. Nobody reads Patrick White these days except myself, but I think he should be brought back into Australian curriculum, and your teachers should talk every morning. But so he was a man who was so profoundly influenced by Gandhiji. And if you read The Tree of Man, Ghost Riders in the Chariot, we were recently overseas and I gave a talk on that book, you will find that how much some of the issues that that we are dealing with in Australia, in India, in America, in Europe, about migration, about immigrants, about refugees, he talked about them 50 years ago. And of course, in 1973, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature, the first and the last so far from our part of the world. The other writer I'm very fond of is V.S. Naipaul, grandson of a Gurmit. Gurmit is a word, have you heard the word Gurmit at all? Gandhiji used that word, Gurmitia, Gurmit. That is, these were the people who were taken as indentured laborers to Fiji, to Mauritius, to South Africa, to Trinidad, Tobago, to Guyana, as indentured laborers after the abolition of slavery in 1833. In 1834, the first indentured laborers were taken to these parts of the world, 2 million of them. Nobody bothered about them, they just got onto a boat. Our grandparents were completely illiterate, and they were taken to these places. My grandfather said he thought Fiji was in the Bay of Bengal, but once he got onto the boat, it took 150 days to reach Fiji, depending on which way the wind was blowing. So these were illiterate people for millennia. And the reason Indians were taken to Fiji is because CSIR Company of Australia had big sugarcane plantations there, and these people were there to work for 10 years, fulfill their indenture. They could retain if they wanted, but many of them stayed on after 10 years. There were young people like you, 17, 18, 19. My grandfather and grandparents, both paternal and maternal, Aja, Aji, Nalanani, as we call them, when they were 17 and 18 years old. So what they created a whole world in Fiji. And Fiji Indians are the only people who in the world have never stolen an acre of indigenous land, never killed an indigenous person. And yet Fiji Indians have gone through 4 coups because indigenous people thought that we were challenging their political power. And of course my prime was Dr. Bhavandra. But that's a story that if you go to Fiji, and I urge you very much, it's only 3.5 hours from Sydney, you will never see anything like that in the South Pacific. At the airport you will see a mosque, a church, a temple, and a huge statue of Hanumanji, who, as you know, was the first jumbo jet flying all over the world with his mace and with his mountain. So my point is this, that Gandhiji was made very much among the indentured Indians of South Africa. He went there at the age of 22. He spent 21 years there. And he's the indentured Indians, particularly Tamil people, small merchants, who who shaped his life, where he practiced satyagraha, where he discovered what how devastating was the racial policy of South Africa. What he started in 1893, on 7th of June 1893, finally in 1994, South Africa became free of apartheid. But without Gandhi, there would be no Nelson Mandela, there would be no Bishop Tutu, there would be no Martin Luther King. And of course, in India, the battles he fought. Tragically, it is in India that he was killed. So whenever I go to India, I make it a point to visit my grave of my mother-in-law with my wife and Mahatma Gandhi's Birla house on 30th January. These are two places of pilgrimage I have in Delhi. And one of them is in Pietermaritzburg, where Gandhiji was thrown out of the train on the night of 7th June 1893. He was a young lawyer dressed in three-piece suit, first-class ticket, but he sat in the wrong compartment. So he was thrown out of the train. And he was only 23. I've been to this place. I went there in 1999. There was a Chogam meeting, and I was invited. So I said, no, I want to go and see this place where Mahatma Gandhi was thrown out of the train. It's about 80 kilometers from Durban. Even in 1999, the place looked so desolate that what affected me very much in the evening was that this man, such a young man, he could have gone back to India. But he said, no, I will fight this racism. I will fight this apartheid that was being practiced by General Smuts and his companions in South Africa. And it's marvelous that he, at that age, decided, he says in his autobiography, that this is, how many of you read his autobiography, My Experiments at Truth? Thank you so much. There's one gentleman there who has read. But it's a wonderful book to read, very simple. Very good. It's a book that you should carry with you all the time. When I was living in Delhi in 1964, a friend of mine gave me a copy. I hadn't read Mahatma Gandhi. Nobody talked about him in my university. We were all studying English literature. But Gandhi's autobiography is the largest selling autobiography in the world. And I think you all should carry a copy of it wherever you go. And you'll find great consolation. You know, I've just written a book called Six Nights in May in 1987, when we were confined and imprisoned for 6 days by the military coup in Fiji. And there, you'll be surprised, there were people, I don't know how many of us are here, but there were 30 of us, and nobody would eat any food until they heard my little talk on Mahatma Gandhi, because he's a man of great courage, the greatest capacity he had was to remake himself. Never give up hope. Keep hope in your hearts and memories of other great men and women in your mind. Gandhi is often said he was a non-violent man. He did do a lot of things non-violent, but he was a very violent man in some way. If you see his past, how violent he was towards his wife or towards his son. He was also, he became a celibate at the age of 37. But he was a profoundly sexy man also until then. He produced four children. And he talked very frankly. The remarkable thing about Gandhi was that everyone, most of us want to hide our darkness, our dark secrets. Gandhi was one man who revealed himself every day in every writing. No man I know, or woman, who has written more than Mahatma Gandhi. The Government of India has published 110 volumes of his works. And yet, half of it is not done, because he wrote everything. This was a great gift he had. Whatever he felt he wrote, whatever he thought he wrote, the magazines, petitions, books, little things. He wrote his famous book, Hind Swaraj, which meant freedom for ourselves, first above all, rather than political freedom or economic freedom or intellectual freedom. It's a freedom that we can enjoy in our hearts and soul. That is a very great gift, and more than the more you think now, the more you see the world, a troubled world. And remember, his contemporaries were people like Churchill, Mussolini, Hitler, Mao Zedong, Stalin, Lenin. But Gandhi's voice today is heard more. And reverberates around the world more, wherever people have been dispossessed, wherever people have been disenfranchised or displaced. It is Gandhi who gives them hope. This wonderful man who, the more you think, the more you marvel. He's often, Patrick White compares him with Buddha and Jesus Christ, and he puts Gandhi in that category. I don't want to put him under the divine being, because he was so human. That is what I find so appealing about. If you are divine, you have to go with your father or with somebody else, with your mother, and people look after you. But he said, no, he was so human. And that is what appeals to me. His, every little child that came to him, he looked after them. Every hungry man who came, he fed them. And he said, all the time, if you read every, his books are full of marvelous quotations, the books that you can get, if you Google it, were full of Gandhiji's quotations. And each quotation has so much strength in it because he was able to think. And once you think and write, these things crystallize from coal into diamonds. And that is what you find in Gandhi, multifaceted diamonds. And I found it that very, very moving. When you consider that all about him, he lived through two world wars, First World War, of course, Second World War, the Holocaust, Hiroshima, Nagasaki. But here was a voice who said, no, there is another way for all of us. What is happening in our own country today? What is it? There's Australia, Fiji, India, Europe, America. Some very disturbing, very troubled world, war weary. We are still killing people in the Middle East. We're dropping bombs every day. So I'm wondering whether young voices like yours could not be heard once again. We are putting horse racing thing on, where is it, in Sydney now, for little gains here and there on the Opera House. And the people are protesting. So Gandhi taught us to protest. One man's voice can change the world. That is what his life gives us. And each one of you, he shows, has this enormous potential. We don't underestimate the power of the human soul. Atom, you know, when it was split, it was made into nuclear fusion, nuclear bombs, hydrogen bombs. Atom comes from the word Atma. The Atma is also very powerful. And that when that Atma has a fusion, you can see how one man, one single man, can change a world when dark clouds are on the horizon all the time. Now, I could go on talking about Gandhiji because I'm just about to complete a book called Gandhi Anjali. Gitanjali, everyone knows. Tagore, my daughter is named Gitanjali.